Hello.
Hey, I am so glad to be on today.
So glad. She said, I am so glad.
So glad. Oh, Lordy.
Night. Hello, movers. How are you doing? We're so glad you decided to join us tonight for Can We Talk? You have tuned into Can We Talk, brought to you by Movement Worldwide. We are a motivational organization there to educate minds, empower, nurture, and transform a movement to move. Yes, a movement to move, helping others thrust into their purpose to live the best version of themselves and win. We've tapped into some winning information. We have some winners' resources. We're seated at the winners' table, and we invite you to sit right along with us, right, Annette?
Yes, as always, we have this table. It's like being in one of those real huge mansions when you had this long table. I mean, it'd be 20 and 30 chairs. Well, we got more chairs than that, okay?
Okay. Say, come on, we got chairs for everybody. So as the saints used to say, come where the table is spread and the feast of the Lord is what?
Guano.
She said, guan. Where the feast of the Lord is guan. She went to the patois on y'all, guan on. Come where the table is spread and the feast of the Lord is guan on. So we're grateful that you decided to join in with us tonight. You could have gone anywhere else with your time, but you chose to come by here with your favorite co-host and have a threefold conversation that we are always have ready for you. We have it geared up and ready, but before we get into it, we want to ask you to do a few things for us. The video that you're watching is either on Facebook, YouTube, or X, formerly known as Twitter. You know, it's funny. It's formerly known as Twitter, but you got to type in twitter.com to get the X. the platform formerly known as Twitter, which is now X. We are live on all of those platforms. So please, the video that you're watching is on one. Please make sure you subscribe. Now, if you subscribe to our YouTube channel, but you're watching on Facebook, please make sure you go and subscribe to the YouTube channel too. And also make sure you follow us on Twitter and send it to other people to follow. So subscribe, hit the like button, those thumbs up button. You can give hearts and hugs and everything else on Facebook. So we ask that you please, ma'am, please, sir, hit those thumbs up buttons, those like buttons, whatever those buttons are for you. We ask that you hit that button and that you give us a little bit of love, little bit of love. Yes, I have some more. We have some more. Hello, movers. We're so glad to see y'all. Jessie Carrot is in the building tonight, Jessie. Y'all. She is here tonight, y'all. Yes. So we're grateful to have you all. Happy Wednesday. And so please subscribe, like, and share. That's the one thing. Subscribe, hit the like button, the love button, hit that curve button, share. You can share it on your page. You can share it in DM. You can click that button on YouTube and on Twitter, formerly known as Twitter. And you can copy it and you can send it out in text message and you can send it out in WhatsApp. You can send it out on email. However, send it out to Lottie Dottie and everybody. We want everybody to be a part of what we're doing tonight. So please, ma'am, please, sir, get this notification out. Let the people know that we are on. Subscribe, like, and share. And you can also sow a seed. We are a nonprofit organization, and we always pray that when you sow a seed into this ministry, that it returns to you 100-fold. So you can sow via Cash App, which is $Movement Worldwide. You can sow via Zelle, which is info@movementworldwide.org. Or you can become a patron, which is a monthly covenant part giver, where you give a certain amount each month. And what you want to know how to become a patron? They want to know, Annette. Should I tell them?
Yeah, go ahead and tell them. Annette.
Okay, Annette said I should tell y'all. So this is go on and tell them. Yeah, so we're going to tell y'all how to do it. Bam, go to our website. There's a red button at the top that says become a patron. When you click that button, it'll take you to a website called patreon.com. That's where you can set up your account and set your amount. Now, we ask for $12 a month. That's our base rate that we ask for. Most of our movers who have become patrons have done it for more than we ask for. So we're always grateful no matter what the amount of the seed. It's all appreciated. So you can set up your account, set your amount. We ask for $12 a month, which is 40 cents a day, $2.80 a week. So that's equivalent to one drink at one of those restaurants that y'all eat now. Y'all know y'all eating lunch and y'all eating, y'all ordering in, you're doing the thing, you're doing the most. So that $2.80, that rounded up to $3 if you want to, but so that $2.80 a week into movement worldwide. We love, love, love your ENCE and need it. We can't do what we do without your PRESENCE, but we also can't do it without your PRESENTS. We need your gifts, your seed.
Yeah.
We need that seed. So please, ma'am, please, sir, sow a seed into movement worldwide. And you can also, everyone that you see that globe above Annette's head, please follow us on all social media platforms where you see that globe and that acronym, that's us. And you can also email us your thoughts, views, comments, praise reports, prayer requests, topic ideas, all to info@movementworldwide.org. Now, without further ado, we're going to go into the first part of our conversation. We like to start off our conversation with those idioms, those topics, those quotes, those phrases, those things that make you go, You hear it all the time. You might hear a saying, That's interesting. So we have one on tonight. So we are grateful, 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 grateful. Yes, share with the people. Let's go. Let's do this. Let's do this. We're going to go straight into the first part of our conversation, which is the transformational topic. Our topic on tonight, though interesting, I used to love, there's a song that has this title. And there's a movie that Denzel Washington played in called Fallen. And it was like the spirit that was getting into different people. And it was one particular spot where the spirit had gotten into his partner and started singing, time is on my side. Yes, it is.
Yeah, that's a good movie.
So that's our topic for tonight. Time is on my side. And I want you to understand that it certainly is. See, we oftentimes get it all mixed up and we get it all misconstrued. But I want you to know today, movers and shakers, movers, our wonderful people, our followers, anybody that's on here tonight, if you have any hint of a question as to whether or not you've missed it, I want you to know that time is on your side. It is definitely on your side. You have to believe that tonight. So I'm going to go into the conversation with this, you know, because I know sometimes we think we've missed it. If you say time is on your side, you know, or that you have time on your side, you mean the phrase basically means that you don't have to do whatever you need to do quickly or whatever it is that you want to do or that you have to do. You don't have to do it so quickly because time is on your side. Well, we all know that we don't control time naturally. No, we don't. God's timing is the timing. It's the true timing, and his timing is perfect. We have all been through seasons, however, in life that feel like we have lost time. Ooh, boy, I have a whole lot for that. If I had a dime, Annette, for every time I felt like I lost time, yeah, I would be rich. You hear me? Jesus. I'm telling you, sometimes I used to feel that way, but I've learned now, you know, I'm in a better space now, and I've learned now, and I think different now, and I do different. But a lot of us have been right there where we felt like we lost time. We're in a relationship that didn't work out, so we lost those years. We weren't raised in a healthy environment. It feels like we've lost our childhood. We came down with an illness or struggled with an addiction months past, maybe years, and it's time that we get it back. But we feel like, oh, I've lost all those years. I've lost all that time. And it's easy to think that was just a rough season. There's nothing that I can do about it. Oh, blah, blah. It's gone. Time lost. Can't get back what I had. Can't get back my time. You know, I hear people say that all the time. That's 3 hours of my time I never get back. It's said that time is the one thing that we can't get back. That's true in the natural, but we have a supernatural God. Who knows how to make up for lost time because he controls it. He's not going to just make up for it. He's going to restore you, and he's going to restore the time that you spent in that relationship that didn't make it. And it feels like it was a waste of time, but God is going to make the rest of your life so fulfilling that you don't think about what you've been through. You learn to move past it. He's not going to just bring you out of that illness, but he's going to restore the years that you spent taking the treatment. Come on, somebody. Your latter days will be better than your former days. That is the type of God that we serve. Now, when I look at Joel 2:25, it says, "And I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, the cankerworm and the caterpillar and the palm worm, and my great army, which I sent among you." Now, when you see this scripture, we all know that when you look at all of these different, you have the locust, the cankerworm, the caterpillar, the palm worm, all of them were eating away at a certain stage of the decay. All the way down to the palm worm who just came and sucked up everything that was left. And even past that, God says that this is how good he is. Here's how good God is. He's even going to restore the years that we've wasted making poor choices, running with the wrong crowd, years that you should have been stuck. Come on, am I talking to anybody tonight? Because when I think about the time, when I think about some of the crowds that I have run in, when I think about how God, you know, has, you know, when I think back sometimes, Annette, sometimes I looked over my life and I was like, oh my God, I should have been dead right there. Come on, that man. Right there really should have taken me out. And when I look at it, I'm like, oh my God, he restored me. I can see where God was working on my behalf when I look back. So he's not, like I say, he's not going to just restore the relationship. He's going to restore the years. He's not going to just restore. He's going to restore everything. When we look at that thing, running with the wrong crowd, the years that you've been studying and you should have been studying, but you've spent it partying. He's going to restore that too. Years that you've been raising children, but you were distracted doing other things. Yeah. Uh-huh. Sometimes like I hear Annette say she can't even recall time for some of the things that she's been through. And look how great her girls turned out. See, God always has a way. He carries us through those times. Years that you should have been pursuing dreams, but you let fear and opposition hold you back. It should be too late. You missed your chance. But God is saying, get ready because I'm about to restore it. I'm about to make up for the time you missed with your children. He's not just going to restore the relationship, but he's going to restore the years. He's going to make it as if you have never lost that time. Time is on your side. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but I feel like this is prophetic for somebody. Just get into the very presence of God and know his will for your life and stay right there. And I guarantee you, you will see the salvation of the Lord. Because time, God's perfect time is on your side. So you haven't lost anything. If anything, you've gained experience. You've gained exposure. You've learned some things. You know what to not do now. You have some relationships and some things and some people have fallen off. You've broken some chains and broken through some barriers. You survived it. You are here. So God is going to do something supernatural in your life. And he has a way of making it seem like it was nothing and that your years to come are much longer than the years that you left behind. Come on, somebody. If you hear me today, God is about to do just that. He is that kind of God. And I don't know about you, but I need God to restore some things in my life. And I'm grateful to know that he will do that. And that's where I'm getting my word for tonight. You all know that I like to take a word that either is in our topic or has something to do with it. So the word that I chose tonight is restore. And it's only in a transitive tense. I like to take a verb. A transitive verb needs an option to make sense. An intransitive verb makes sense without one. But tonight's word that I chose is transitive, and it needs an object to make sense, which I'm the object. And so what it means is to give back, to return, or to renew. And I'm so grateful to know that I have a God who will not only give me back what I thought I lost, but he will return some things to me that I thought were gone and were not salvageable, like those relationships with your children, with your family members. God's going to return that and he will renew you. He will make it so good because restoration is always better than before. He's going to make you so new that it's going to be better than you ever thought it could have been. That is who he is. So time is on your side. Your thoughts, Annette?
Yeah, when you were saying about the supernatural, I was thinking, I said God would take the natural and put super on it and change the natural totally. I love that kind of God. And you're right. You're right. God will, the thing that you thought would destroy you, it was over. I don't know if I can live with it. Oh, God. And then you look back years later, say, you know, because I had that experience a couple of weeks ago, a person I knew, and I looked at him like, okay, all right. You mean to tell me, God, that I spent all them years crying and rolling on the floor, and, you know, but I had to go through that. That was, God has always been, God's time anyway, it's always been on my side. And sometimes we don't even realize that, Anita, because we, at the time when you're going through, you don't know that. You don't feel that. People say stuff and you'd be like, you know how it is, Anita. Sometimes somebody want to hit, come in and tell you some scripture, you'd be looking like, I really want them to hush because I don't want to hear that right now.
I don't want to hear it right now.
Not right now, but we didn't understand that God had already worked it out. Oh, my thing that like killed you, that thing that you didn't think you would overcome, the way they treated you, talked about you, scandalized you, and the list go on and on. But time is God's perfect time, and that Kairos time has always been on your side. Mm-hmm. Always.
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 You don't have
yes,
to worry.
Yes, I love that. You took me back with that movie.
Yeah, time. Yeah, that was a fun. That was a funny little part.
So, it was.
Yes. So I'm grateful. I'm grateful that I serve a God who's that good to me.
Yeah.
Who's that good to me, and He's going to restore and renew me and make me better than I was before. I thought things were so great then, and I thought I was just going to die if I didn't have everything right in that moment that I thought I needed. Oh God. And the one thing that you think you need the most be the one thing that you think be thinking God got away from you. Woo, Jesus.
Oh my, me.
Thank you, Lord. Woo. So mercy. I'm grateful. All right, good people. Well, that was our transformational topic. That's our first phase of our conversation. We're getting ready to go to the second phase. But before we do, it's time for our toast. Get out your mug. It's time for our toast. Bam. Bam, bam, hold it up to the screen. Give us a toast. Yes, oh, yes.
Wow. Bring it. And a little girl sitting there.
Yes. Right. So before we go to the next phase of our conversation, we're going to pause for just a moment and go to our wonderful codologist, wordologist, our linguist, our poet, our writer, author extraordinaire. We're going to pause for our Annette-ism by Annette L. Anderson before we go to the next phase of our conversation. And while we're paused, please pay attention to that Annette-ism. Let it minister, but make sure you're sharing and letting somebody know we're on. Keep sharing this broadcast and let the people know we are on. And we'll be right back in about a minute and a half.
Each day, I will say that he may lead the way. Please don't delay. My skies are gray. Life is in disarray. It's on full display. Need your help today. You seem to be far away. On my knees, I pray. Just trying to convey. God, hear me as I say. Trust in you in time of delay. But God, I still will obey. Trust you will not go astray. Regardless, with you I'll stay. God, I want to be your protege. So others will see you are the way. This is Annette-ism's expressions. All righty, it's time for the power tool. There are some matters and experiences that causes people to become hurt, fractured or broken spiritually and emotionally. Sometimes it just takes a conversation. Sometimes it just takes time for somebody to talk with you, to sit with you, to mend the broken heart or spirit. In some cases, a Band-Aid won't do. You need a power tool.
Power tool.
Tonight, the power tool would be changing roles in life. Changing roles in life. I thought about this when I was reflecting over my own life, how in the last 3 years, there's been some changes, some roles that have changed in my life. You know, I'm still a mother, I'm still a grandmother, wife, and all that stuff. But I'm no longer working, I'm no longer controlled about a set time to do anything. And so I'm thinking about the roles that I've had to go through. You know, I went through a lot, and I've said so many times how I bought all this stuff, a sewing machine couldn't sew, you know, a press I couldn't press, you know, you name it, I got it probably. I had it and giving it away. But, you know, but life changes and the roles change. And sometimes I dare say we are not comfortable where we are, because if you're used to doing something for so long, like I worked for over 40 years between my two jobs, I worked 40 years plus. And, you know, some of that under table stuff, you know, but I worked at least 40 years of my life. And so when I look and I reflect back over that, how it's changed, how the outlook have changed, the way I view a situation have changed. And so when I began to really put this together, I was thinking, you know, how some of us struggle in that area. You know, we get older, whatever the case may be, you know, just so many changes. Don't always have to be age. It can be situations. But questions are an effective technique for reflecting and understanding what your life roles are. Sometimes you need to ask yourself, where am I? What am I supposed to do? I even asked God, where will you have me to do? You know, when I first retired, I just was so excited about retiring. I had a couple of dollars. I just went on a spending spree. I just went crazy spending. And I was like, oh, I could do that. Oh, I could do that. You know, until I finally got to a place that I had to narrow down what the role, my role would be. Change can take many forms. Sometimes we choose it and sometimes it happens. Sometimes we choose it and sometimes it chooses us. For some, they may want a sibling role, a parent role, you know, I never want to do that. I don't want to babysit. You know, I'm not one of those kind of grandmothers. You can drop your children at my house. That's I already know that's not my role. For others, they may, you know, the role may be their family. There are some people who don't. I love my grandkids dearly, but I've already did the children thing, you know. But some people will have careers or work roles, or others may choose to have many. Some people have multiple things they do. It's up to you, like Anita. She has multiple jobs she does. She carries many hats she wears. She wears many, many hats. She carries many, many people along the way. It is all up to us how, you know, we group the responsibilities and activities in our lives. We're happy. But my question really tonight is, are you happy with the status quo? Are you really happy where you are? And so one of the things I realized once I retired, I remember sitting on my desk one day and I was saying, I said, I can't do this no more. I can't run another case. I can't hear nobody's sob story. I don't want to hear if your children are eating tonight. And that was not being mean. It was nothing against the clients. I just was tired of hearing the same thing after 37 years. And I said, well, it's got to be more than this. I can't solve your problems. You know, and I had got to the place where someone said something to me and I responded and it wasn't nice. They told me, I bet you're going to eat tonight. I said, yes, I am. That's why I work. I said, then it's time to leave because that's not how you handle when people are going through. That's not how you should respond. But I don't care who you are. There are times there's a breaking point where, you know, like it's time for me to change. I can't. And I told myself I couldn't. However, life doesn't always comply with our wishes. And we are faced with major transitions. The course of our adulthood has changed radically in recent decades. The education path, the work path, you know, we got technology, everything's changing and reshaping. One of the things that was very difficult for me when we went into, we changed and we started, going into this technology and everything was on, the computer. Well, I bucked against it because I like the fact I can go to the file room and I could pull a case, you know, and do whatever I need to do. But what I had to realize that it was a role change, that we weren't going to do it that way anymore. And even some of our clients, they had issues trying to, you know, I'm not using a computer well, but then you're going to get left behind, baby, because sometimes it's just time to change, you know. So there are things that changes and it triggers our life, and it makes us look at life different. It makes us look at our roles, you know, that we are to engage. It also makes us look at, okay, I've been doing this so long, can I do something else? And so this is why we get caught and we stay in places we should not stay for so long, because we're so scared, because that's all we have known for so long. And so we have to step out and say, you know what? I know I've done this 30 years, 40 years, but it's time for a change. So these events can motivate adults to seek out new learning experiences. That's one of the things, you know, because life will throw a wrench. Right? I mean, you have everything lined up and life will come and just, you know, change everything. You know, life, it could be a serious accident, illness, career change, promotion, I mean, layoff, retirement, you know, grandmother becoming caretakers. There's a lot of grandmothers that had to raise their grandkids, separation or divorce. So that there comes a time in our lives when our roles change. And so what happens when our roles change? Because I know we buck against it. We don't want to, you know, do it because I can't do anything else. And I don't know why we tell ourselves we can't do anything else, that we'll never make it. You know, I don't understand, especially those of us who are saved. We serve a God that's, we talk about he has cattle on the hill. Well, if he do, I want one of the cattle. You know, we got to get, stretch our minds, and we get so caught up and we stuck. And I'm talking about me. Stuck in a rut because I was scared to step out because what about my check? Well, what about the bill? You know, all that stuff. But then, you know, I had to get to a place in my life that my role had to change, Anita. So what this is what I had to do. And it took me a minute, but I did it. I had to change how I think. The way you think about change plays a major role in determining how well you deal with it. Mm. Focus on the positive aspects of change and look for opportunities to learn and to grow. The problem is a lot of us have stopped learning. Baby, you're going to learn until Jesus come back. It's out there. You got to learn. You got to see. You got to. I have learned so much. I learned stuff I didn't even know was out there. You know, I learned that, oh, Black people don't do this. And the devil is a liar. We do great things. We do great exploits. But if you never, you know, if you never look or you never study, I see people, oh, you know, they talk about this entertaining, that entertaining. They should do this and do that. Well, start reading, because a lot of them give major, major money. But if we don't change out the way we think, if we don't educate ourselves and, you know, read, okay, I know you love Jesus. I do too. But sometimes you got to pick up more than a Bible. Trust me when I tell you this. You really do, because there's so much that God have out there. Then we have to, you know, understand, we try not to maintain routines. I try to get out of routines because that's what happens with work. It's a routine. I knew what I was going to do. At this time we do, you know, we meet together. At this time they tell us what we haven't done. I asked my supervisor one time, I said, do I do anything right? Because that's all I ever heard. You know, we didn't meet the numbers, you know? So, you know, sometimes we got to get away. I know we like our routine. I know we get up in the morning, have our coffee, pray, whatever you do. But every now and then you got to step away from the routines. Then you got to practice self-care, because when you make that transition, when you go to this other place, change can be stressful because your body's used to a routine. You're used to getting up, you know, and for maybe about a month, I was like, oh, I got to get up. And that's, I'm retired, you know, but it took me a moment. So I had to practice self-care to make sure I was getting enough sleep, eating well, taking care, doing the things I needed to do, because now there was a shift in the way things I've done, the way I think, the way I act. Then we have to lean into social support. Connecting with and communicating with others is important, because a change is going to come. The role will change. Life will happen. But what are you doing when your role changes? Don't allow the roles to change and you don't. Don't allow things to happen and you know, you got this great opportunity to go, you know, go for a walk, and I'm getting ready to do that, trust me, I am, and you know, enjoy life, go to a movie by myself, I'll go out and eat by myself. You know, these are the things we have to learn, because our roles have changed. You know, your role, you know, you may be, everything may be well for you. You may be working, you know, you get up the next morning, you can't get up out of bed. We never know what life throws at us. So we have to make sure when these roles change that we change with the roles. We change with the roles and ask God to give us insight in what to do. And one of the things, when I retired, I hit the ground running and I just bought so much stuff, you know, but I was determined. I said, I refuse to sit around and sit on my seat or do nothing. I'm going to do something, because my role has changed, and I'm going to take every opportunity that I have to change in the role. So, and there's a couple of scriptures I want to leave with you. Hebrews 13:8 says this: Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, same yesterday and today and forevermore. So you have to know that even though you have changed, you changed role, Jesus will never change. And sometimes you have to really talk to him. I spend a lot of time. My husband get up 5 a.m. I don't get up with him, but I spend a lot of my personal time talking to God, asking him to lead and guide me, telling him to lead, you know, lead the way. And I know I fall, and I ask God, I said, touch my mind, make, cause me to remember social media and all these things. I'm trying to be able to grasp all these concepts and all these changes because I didn't do it. I only learned a computer that was connected to my job. Anything out of that, I didn't care. But I'm asking God to help me in that. And 2 Corinthians 5:17 says this, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things are become new. So with this new role, now you've become new. That old stuff gone. Then you got to figure out, how do I go from here? How do I get to the next step in my life? Because now I have a new role. Now I have a new way of doing things. It's not like the old. I never want to go back to where I was. Why? Because I was stagnated. I had got complacent, and I wasn't going no further than from 8 to 5. Anything after that, I wasn't going to do. So tonight, I'm just leaving this with you. What do you do when changing roles in life happens? What do you do? So we have to know that your role will change, whether it's retirement, whether it's a sickness, even I'll say this and I'll end with this. Even when my brother died, it changed. My role changed. That just rocked me. So there will be things that happen in your life that will change the role. And what happened with me, I started even thinking the more, okay, God, I got to run. I got to do something. I got to work, because we don't know when it's our last breath. So while I'm on this earth, I'm going to do all I can to become all that he has predestined for me to be. And that is the power tool for tonight.
My God. That was really, really powerful, because, you know, we don't even think, Annette, sometimes, and that we, how resistant we are to the changes in life.
Yeah.
And I remember when my mom was, when her health was beginning to decline, and I took her on a trip for her birthday, and I just had a heart to heart with her. I said, now, I know that you like to be independent and all of that, but because we're going to be moving around a lot, it's not because you have to, but it's easier for us and safer for you if we get a wheelchair. And she said, I ain't gonna fight y'all no more. And so when she said that, I was like, okay, so now, you know, she's on board, and we don't have to, you know, we don't have to have this fight no more. So I was grateful, because it's hard. It's hard for older people to give up, you know, and to, you know, to you know, give in to their children. It's hard for them to do that. And one day that's going to be us. And I always prayed and asked God, you know, please let me be receptive. If, you know, if you see fit for me to live to be that age, and I need somebody to take care of me, I don't want to be ornery and, you know, all of that stuff. So I pray all the time about that, because I've seen it. You know, my mom was pretty good. She wasn't, you know, she wasn't hard to take care of, but I've seen some situations where people had a hard time taking care of their loved one because they were mean and rude and ugly, or they have Alzheimer's, they're not in their right mind. So yeah. I'm grateful to God for that I didn't have that. And I pray for people who had that, because it is a tougher job to do. But your roles will change. And as time goes, and God is shifting you, because he shifts me all the time when it comes to occupation, work, different things. And when he's shifting your life, you have to go with the shift, because you're transitioning to a different place. And God is using you differently, even though, you know, you're called and all that stuff. It doesn't mean that all of the things that you know how to do that you don't know how to do, you know, this person that you've become, this elder or this teacher or whatever it is, it just means that God is now trying to use you differently. He's transitioning you into a new space, and don't resist it, because change in life. So thank you for that, Annette. That was really good, really powerful. All righty. That was our second phase of our conversation, y'all. We get ready to go have some fun. Y'all saw the thumbnail. There's some other stuff on the thumbnail. Some other stuff in there that y'all don't see on the thumbnail, but I know y'all saw the thumbnail. You're probably like, ooh, child, they're going there. Ooh, I got to see. I got to get the tea. So you're coming to get the tea. But before we get the tea, we're going to pause right now for a commercial break. And when we come back, we're going to have a powerful, powerful discussion. And we're going to have some, listen, the tea is going down. All righty. So we'll be back in about 2.5 minutes, and you can still share. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Walk into your God-given destiny with power and conviction with Power Walk Sunday. Each and every Sunday at 10 a.m. live on multiple platforms. When we eat well, we live well, and all will be well. Go to elbwell.com, join the journey, and take your life back. TNT, that's Tuesday Night Talk with the Andersons, each and every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. live on multiple platforms. For more information and other services, visit AnnetteLAnderson.com. Your faithful co-hosts, Annette and Anita, along with the best mods this side of heaven, are live on Clubhouse in the Movers and Shakers house with Operation Manifestation every Friday night at 8 p.m. You don't want to miss this fiery conversation. If you don't have your copy yet, get yours today at Amazon.com. That's Living Life One Quote at a Time by Annette L. Anderson. Another milestone reached. Get your copy of The Wow Effect by Anita Faye Wilson, available on all platforms, or you can visit AnitaFayeWilson.com. And you can always catch us live on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for Can We Talk? Join us with your Can We Talk coffee mug. Get yours today. They're $15, and that includes shipping. So good seed into good soil. You can sow a seed into Movement Worldwide via Cash App at $Movement Worldwide, Zelle at info@movementworldwide.org, or by becoming a patron. You can visit our website at movementworldwide.org, click the red button, go to patreon.com, and set up your account today. And remember to follow us on all platforms, like, subscribe, click that notification button, and don't forget to share. It's that time, Tea Time Topics. It's time for Tea Time Topics. Tea Time Topics, go in there, and Tea Time Topics, come on now. Ooh, ooh, get it, girl. Ooh, ooh, ow, ow. Oh, you're a little offbeat there, but it's all right. You were like on the wrong, you know, it was okay.
You know what was happening? Yeah. I was like, I'm the music.
You were like bouncing to the wrong beat, like the one and the three instead of the two and the four. But that's all right. That's all right. All right, y'all. We're ready to go into our tea time topics. Y'all already know we have all the tea, and we also have some history, but we're gonna go to the first one. Who's woke now? All right, now, who's woke now? Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, whose hardline right-wing policies in his state garnered much public attention and made him an early favorite for the 2024 presidential race, suspended his bid for the Republican nomination on Sunday in a video posted on X, formerly known as Twitter. DeSantis also endorsed former President Donald Trump, not surprised, and frontrunner for the GOP presidential nomination. If there was anything I could do to produce more favorable outcome, more campaign stops, more interviews, I would do it. I can understand when he talks. He speaks so scripted to me. I don't know, this man here, he just runs me hot. But I can't ask you for our volunteers to volunteer their time and to donate the resources if we don't have a clear path to victory. DeSantis, you didn't have one from the beginning. Campaign message was that he would be better at delivering the same kinds of policies that Trump would be in favor of because he doesn't have the same baggage that Trump carries from his numerous indictments and federal charges. He vowed to rid the country of wokeism, a term he often used to criticize liberal policies, win the presidency by a wide margin, and deliver on issues that the Republicans care about, much like how he says he has in Florida. Toward the end of his campaign, DeSantis began to throw harder jabs at Trump himself. During the visit to New Hampshire in December, DeSantis said he thought Trump would accept the results of the contest. If Trump loses, he will say is stolen no matter what. Absolutely, he told reporters. He will try to delegitimize the results. Okay, so if you know that, then why do y'all get amnesia when people ask y'all about it? And why do you have it now? You're going to go and support somebody that you know. You're obviously saying it. And this is what kills me about them. But anyway, your thoughts on it?
Yeah, they do that. And I think a lot of them were saying this kind of stuff because they didn't, a lot of them didn't think he would win the nomination for the Republicans. It's several of them have been walking back the words. I've been watching. Oh, I didn't say that. Listen to the rest of it. I see that I would never make it because I said it, and now what? You know what I'm saying? But they are wuss. That's what they are. So be a man. If you said it, you said it. You know, they're so scared. How you let some man don't even put his makeup on right, traumatize y'all like that?
Exactly.
I mean, he never put, for whatever reason, it's always white around his eyes. And y'all, I mean, they shaking in their boots right now, some of them. Yeah. I probably been in a chat. They've been fired me.
Listen, I ain't taking back nothing I say. If I said it, I said it.
And now what? Then my question would be, now what? Okay, I said it. Now what you gonna do?
Exactly. And the answer is absolutely nothing. You're not gonna do anything about it. I say what I said, and it's a done deal. Period.
And look at Tim Scott when he was up there.
Oh my God! Karen, I was like, today. Karen says, Karen said, look at Tim.
Tim up there.
Looking like an idiot.
And he all on the beach and on his knees asking woman to marry. I thought to myself, I think he's trying to, they probably tell him he need to do something like that. If he, you know, because they were saying whatever. But anyway, at the end of the day, they all going to be eating cheese.
Okay.
I don't get it.
Yeah, girl. That's one of them things we're going to have to ask Jesus about.
Yeah, that's right, because he's an old, wrinkled, he's just an old man who talked tough and eat a lot of McDonald's, they say. I don't know.
But it's funny how, like you said, you titled it, like, Are You Woke Now?
Yeah.
Or You got to go back with your tail between your legs.
You're going to get rid of it. See, number one, you can't do in Florida. He was gonna win anyway because he can't do in Florida what he can't do that in the rest of this country.
No,
you know, and one thing about Trump, he would whatever the wind blow with him, he wouldn't get into these kind of fights because Trump for the rich folks, so he would have never got in the fight with Disney, he just wouldn't, you know. Right. So, hey, that's crazy. What it get.
Crazy, crazy, and you can take crazy. Come on, fellas, come and take crazy off the stage.
Take him on.
Next topic.
Moving. We keep it moving.
Okay. This is sort of sad little story.
Yes.
Yeah. Dexter Scott King, who dedicated much of his life to shepherding the civil rights and legacy of his parents, the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. and Coretta Scott King, died this Monday, after battling prostate cancer. He was 62. He was also a part of the King Center in Atlanta, which Dexter King served as chairman, said the youngest son of the civil rights icon daddy. Oh, I put that in twice. Oh, his wife, Leah Weber King, said in a statement that he died peacefully in his sleep. The third of the King's four children, Dexter King, was named for the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church in Montgomery, Alabama, where his father served as a pastor when a Montgomery bus boycott launched him to national prominence in the wake of the 1955 arrest of Rosa Parks. I didn't know. That's why I named him. Dexter King was 7 years old when his father was assassinated in April 1968. And it's something they're trying to go backwards while supporting striking sanitation workers in Memphis, Tennessee. He turned the pain to activism, however, and dedicated his life to advancing, still talking about Dexter, advancing the King, Dream Martin and Coretta Scott King had for their children and others. The Reverend Al Sharpton said in a statement, he says, Dexter King left us far too soon. Dexter King described the impact of the family, his father's killing had on his childhood and the rest of his life in a 2004 memoir. Growing up King. Ever since I was seven, I felt I must be formal. He wrote, adding formality, seriousness, and servitude. All of these are difficult to poses to maintain, even if a person with all drama life throws at you. In other words, he's saying it's hard to live up to what people thought he should be. As an adult, Dexter King bore such a striking resemblance to his famous father that he was cast to portray him in 2002 TV movie about Parks starring Angela Bassett. He really did like his dad. He also worked to protect the family King property. In addition to serving as chairman of the King Center, he was also president of the King's estate. Words cannot express the heartbreak that I feel from losing another sibling, said Bernice King, as she said in a statement. Martin Luther King III said, "The sudden shock is devastating. It's hard to have the right words at a moment like this." And they went on to say that they asked for prayers at this time, and a memorial will be announced later. But the family did hold a news conference Tuesday in Atlanta. And so, yeah, that's Dexter. Now, Dexter and Yolanda look just like Dr. King. Mm-hmm. It really did.
Really noticed. I was looking too, and somebody said they never really noticed how much he looked like his dad.
Oh, just like him, yeah.
Like paid attention to that one son, because he just, he was out of the limelight a lot.
Yeah.
And so you always see the older one who does not look like his dad at all. And then, of course, there was Bernice, but then the one Yolanda looked like him to me. And mm-hmm. yeah, mm-hmm. he looked a lot like his dad. But yeah, so, our thoughts and prayers go out to the family.
Yeah.
I think it was Elena said that he is resting in heaven, leaving the world behind such a powerful legacy in his father. So we just pray for his family, his wife, and his siblings, because it's hard. It's difficult. And now it's only two of them left. Two of them left and one grandchild out of all of those children. Wow.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Wow.
There's that one granddaughter that does the speech, the poetry.
Well, which is that Martin Luther King III's child? Whose child is that?
It's his Martin Luther King III's child.
Oh, okay. I knew it was one, but I didn't. I just thought she was the one in the limelight. Oh,
she's the only grandchild of Martin Luther King. Mm-hmm. The only grandchild, and there ain't gonna be no more because they're all too old to have children. That's it. So, amazing, huh? Woo! Yeah. So we don't really have a sound for that, but our thoughts and prayers go out. Come on, fellas, take a
step.
Moving. We keep it moving.
All righty. Here we go. This is an interesting story. A man who served 14 years in prison for a deadly 1990 shooting was exonerated Thursday after prosecutors said they now believe the killer was an acquaintance he has implicated for decades. "I lost 14 years of my life for a crime I did not commit," Stephen Ruffin told a Brooklyn judge after sighing with emotion. Although Ruffin was paroled in 2010, and has since built a career in sanitation in Georgia, he said that getting his manslaughter conviction dismissed and his name clear will help me move on. "If you know you're innocent, don't give up on your case. Keep fighting because justice will prevail," Ruffin, 45, said outside court. "That's all I've wanted for 30 years, somebody to listen and really hear what I'm saying and look into things I was telling them." Prosecutors said that they were exploring whether to charge the man they now believe shot 16-year-old James Delaney on Brooklyn Street during a February 1996 confrontation over some stolen earrings. Brooklyn District Attorney Eric Gonzalez said after court that charges, if any, would come immediately. "You have to be able to convict someone beyond a reasonable doubt, and we have to make sure that the evidence is sufficient to do so," said Gonzalez, who wasn't DA when Ruffin was tried. "You have a lot of factors working against us, procedurally, but also factually. Unfortunately, this is 30 years ago. Ruffin's conviction is the latest of more than three dozen that Brooklyn prosecutors have disavowed, after reinvestigations over the last decade. We only wish that in 1996, Detective Scarsella and others had performed the investigations they should have and been able to get this right the first time," Attorney Garrett Ordower said. noting that this guy's family may now never have the finality of a conviction in his death. As for Ruffin, he's focused on his future, including promotion opportunities at his job in Atlanta. He is now voided conviction, and he said, never defined me. It never defined me. So that's an interesting story. And I feel him, you know, it's like you know, it was 30 years ago, but his life has been like really under scrutiny and just in chaos for all those years, even though he was paroled in 2010 and he built, you know, a life, has a career and everything, but he was still carrying the ugly stain of that conviction. Every time he went somewhere, every time you apply for something, every time that stain of conviction was over your head, you Google your name, you see that you were convicted of a crime that you did not commit. So your thoughts on it?
I just hope he sues.
Ha!
No, I do, because he didn't do it. Mm-hmm. And he tried to tell them, and they didn't care as long as they got a conviction. Also, I don't know how they sleep at night, but some people, their heart is that they need a new heart. I don't know how you can do stuff and don't bother you, but mm-hmm. I mean, you know, hey, I hope he sues, and I hope he get lots of money.
She said, I hope he sues. And not only that he sues, but
lots
that
of money.
Lots of money. Yeah.
It's 14 years of that man's life.
A lot of years of his life. A lot of years of his life. Can't say sue. And, you know, I am with you. He does need to. He needs to sue, and he needs to get his money. Go ahead and get paid. But we are so happy that you are now exonerated. We give it a thumbs up.
Yes.
Go on to live your life, but sue, baby, sue. All right, fellas, come on, take us to the next one.
Moving. We keep it moving.
I love this story because you can't stop progress. As much as they try to whitewash and do all kinds of stuff in this country, God still come right on back and bless. Spelman College in Atlanta will receive the largest single financial donation ever made to a historically black college or university, the school announced on last Thursday. Billionaires Rhonda Stryker and William Johnston will donate $100 million. Did y'all hear me? $100 million to the Women's College. Stryker is a member of Harvard Medical School Board of Fellows and a member of the College Board of Trustees. She is also the granddaughter of the founder of Stryker Corporation, a medical device company. Her husband, Johnston, is the founder and board chairman of Greenleaf Trust, a wealth management firm in Michigan. The college is both invigorated and inspired by that generous donation. Spelman College President Dr. Helen Gale said in a statement, "The gift is a critical step in our school's mission to eliminate financial barriers to starting and finishing a Spelman education," Gale added. We can't thank Rhonda Stryker enough for her selflessness and support as both a trustee and friend. There's no doubt that Spelman College is better because of her. Spelman is a private liberal arts college. The college has received other significant large donations in the past, including a $10 million donation last February from Rosemary K. and John W. Brown to support the construction of its Mary Smith Campbell PhD Center for Innovation and Art, which is scheduled to open this fall. Most of Stryker, and Johnson donation, $75 million, will fund endowed scholarships for future students, while the remaining $25 million will be used to develop an academic focus in public policy and democracy, involve student housing, and provide flexible funding to meet critical strategic needs, according to a statement. Stryker says she cares deeply for the sisterhood the college has created, and education is powerful and transformational for women. Yeah.
I love that. You know what?
I love that.
I love it. With stamp of approval. Yes.
Yes.
I love it. What a stamp of approval. I agree with you wholeheartedly, Elena. That's amazing. And you know what? And it's like when people try to count it out and, you know, and give HBCUs a bad name and all that kind of stuff. Let me tell you, you can't stop. You can't stop what God does. You can't stop it. Y'all can try, but you can't. just like with the whitewashing and the books and everything else, all this stuff happening in Florida, trust me, whatever. You just go ahead when you get out of this state, and we can go back to our values, because yeah. You come here and try to make this place like 1929 or, mm-hmm. or further back, you know, but... So I just love it when we get these kind of stories. It's definitely something to applaud. So we give them the team up and the applause from Movement Worldwide. That is great. Great story. All right, fellas, come on.
Moving, moving, moving. We keep it moving.
Woosa.
I'm sorry.
Woosa. Massachusetts man convicted of murder in 2021 death of a black man after a racist road rage encounter was sentenced Wednesday to life in prison with the possibility of parole after 15 years. Dean Capsalis of Hudson was convicted by a jury last year of second-degree murder, violation of constitutional rights, and other offenses in the killing of Henry Tapia. Capsalis and Tapia got into an argument on January 19, 2021. Investigators found that this argument wound down. Capsalis shouted out a racial slur and then hit Tapia with his pickup as he drove off. Tapia died at a hospital, prosecutors said. Now see, you know, I just have an issue with the second degree because, you know, it's like, truthfully, you can see that that was not second degree murder. When you run over somebody with your car, that's intentional.
Yeah, I totally agree.
They, you know, ain't nothing second degree about it. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and finish this article. This, they done pissed me off already. Jeez. Investigators found the argument wound down. Capsalis shouted a racial slur and then hit Tapia with his pickup as he drove off. Tapia died in the hospital. Prosecutors said the murder of Henry Tapia is a senseless tragedy fueled by hate and anger, District Attorney Marion Ryan said last year after the conviction. The fact that some of the last words Henry Tapia heard were horrific racial insult meant and intimidate and threaten him based on the color of his skin is something we cannot tolerate. Judge David Deakin, according to the Boston Globe, called the sentence Wednesday proportional to the crime. While he took into account the support the capsalist received from his friends and family, he noted that your record reflects essentially a lifelong tendency toward violence. The act can also address relatives of Tapia who left behind a fiance and children. I am well aware that no sentence can give them what they want most, which is to have Mr. Tapia back, Deakin told. But if I could, I would do anything other than that. Capsalis argued that a trial that Tapia's death was an accident, whatever. His sentencing was delayed by his unsuccessful attempt to reduce his conviction to manslaughter. Well, I'm glad that that part was unsuccessful, but second degree murder, I think, is too small for this crime. And it just aggravates me so much when I see this kind of foolishness. And, you know, I'm glad he's getting some, but look at that face. He needs more for what he did. Your thought in it?
I think you summed it up. I totally agree. I don't understand how he got away with the second, but you know, they be, what do you say, second degree? But they be making deals and stuff, just trying to get, you know.
It's the deals so, that they make.
Yeah.
It's. But you look at his face. You see that little smug, that little.
Yeah.
I just cannot stand it. It's aggravating when I see stuff like that. And granted, at the end of the day, that wasn't no accident. You did exactly what you intended to do.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Man's life. But you know what? God's eyes are not closed. He is not asleep. He's watching every move you make and every secret you keep. And even that secret that you know in your heart that you killed that man intentionally, trust me, you will not rest. I know my God, he will not acquit the wicked. Boom. So, but anywho, I ain't got no, all I got for him is this. I got that for him. and he better be careful when he on the inside. Listen, he on the inside looking around like,
oh my God.
Yeah, it's gonna be a different story.
Yeah, then watch his back. Ask George, the one that killed George Floyd.
Uh-huh. Watch it back. Uh-huh. But ask Chauvin. He'll tell you. All right, fellas, come on, take us to the next one. I done woosahed and got it out of my system.
Moving, moving, moving. We keep it moving.
Okay. Titus Shields began working at a jail in February 2022. He filed a lawsuit. Okay. The lawsuit states Shields was forced to work in a hostile environment after he reported the racial abuse suffered by Black inmates of the jail and that the county discriminated against him due to his race, complaints of race discrimination, and reports of wrongdoing. The former corrections officer said he was given positive feedback during the probationary period until he began reporting about this discrimination against Black inmates at the jail. Shill revealed one incident where an officer removed the inmate's mattress in bed and during freezing weather with cold air blowing into his cell. The inmate was placed in a restraint chair without explanation and forced to sleep on a metal bed frame for approximately 8 days. Another inmate was also strapped to the restraint chair as several officers assaulted him. And after one officer questioned it, if the abuse was excessive force, Sergeant DeCaney said, "What excessive force? It's part of our job, dude." The complaint describes. She also said he was reporting the abuse, and DeCaney, yeah, do it. Do you think anybody really cares? Do you think you're going to change anything? You're not. She claims that when he made complaints about the abuse and said he no longer felt safe, Deputy Warren White told Shields to get over it. It's not about you. She was allegedly told by Sergeant Harris, who is Black, yes, it is very racist here, and you have got to watch your back, Harris said. Also told Shields, these people do a lot of dirt and can get away with it. So just keep your head down and you'll be all right. The warden also told Shields, wow, what kind of warden is he? You're going to have to find some way to deal with it or you're going to lose your job. Following the complaints, Shields said he was harassed by his co-workers. His car was vandalized with the N-word scratched into it, and he once found his lunch with spit and snot in it. Shields said he also found notes of racial slurs and chewing tobacco spit into his locker. Shields was fired in October 2022 and filed a complaint with the EEOC Commission on February 2023. In his lawsuit, Shields is seeking wage loss damages, including back pay and front pay, as well as a compensatory and punitive damage. Shields is also asking for costs of his attorney fee. And the part got me when they spit and see, I would have had to be, see,
I've been
swinging. Oh, I've been fighting. Hey. Oh, we were going to be windmilling somebody. So I would never take
it. Wait, I had this big job. And then you might be windmilling.
Because I know they're coming. I'm going to take it to them because you spit. That is so nasty. It's and nasty. They probably sit back laughing.
I just can't. I can't. And it's sad because they don't want you to tell the truth. Now, as long as you just sugarcoating and you, yes, sir, boss, and all, you're fine. But the minute you go and tell the truth, they make it hard for you. And this poor man had to go through some stuff. Baby, sue, and get that money, honey. And I want the person who horked up and spit in his food. I want to get that. If they could give me 5 minutes with that person in the bathroom. Like Medea say, give me 5 minutes with her in the bathroom. They give me 5 minutes. All I need is 5 minutes. Boy, I'll put something on him. He won't even be able to pucker up and spit no more.
Come on, man. That is so nasty.
You hear me what I say now? He won't be able to listen. That mouth will be so dry, he won't be able to even muster up anything. He won't even have no taste buds when I get through. Jesus, that's disgusting. I can't stand that. There are people like that in the world.
Yeah, sure is.
We do. All right, fellas, come on, take us.
Moving, moving, moving. We keep it moving.
Okie dokie. All right, let me get to my right spot here. Oh, I'm on the wrong spot. Oh, here it is. I've been doing comedy for almost 40 years, and I'm only 50 years old, Dave Chappelle said as he qualified himself as an OG in the game, noting he has performed everywhere, including baby showers, christenings, weddings, etc. But then he asked, what part of the game is this? He ethered the N-word from our little perspective or whatever. I don't like, didn't like that word. He didn't say anything about any of the white boys. None of these white boys function like that. Chappelle says this domino effect is simply not good for their business or the small, tightly knit Black comedian community. While never saying he agreed or disagreed with Williams' claims, the inebriated, what did I put that in there? Chappelle pointed out that Williams did not mention the multiple allegations against white comedians that are thriving in Hollywood. Funny man George Carlin was accused of stealing jokes from the Bowery Boys and Abbott and Costello in the previous. Milton denied those allegations, telling Larry King once, I don't steal people's jokes. I just find them before they're lost. Names like Conan O'Brien, Jay Moore, who actually admitted to stealing from Rick Shapiro. Amy Schumer, Woody Allen, Joan Rivers, and even Robin Williams have come up as comedians who stole material from their comics and X, formerly known as Twitter, but none were mentioned by Williams. In Williams' defense, perhaps they are not mentioned because they did not steal from Williams himself. Cat is one of the best painters in the game. So why are you drawing ugly pictures of us? Chappelle says, stop. Hurt people, but I'm a hurt person that never hurt people, and he does it all the time. And I'm gonna let you give your thoughts first, Annette, and then I do have my thoughts.
Well, first of all, we already know that as far as Dave Chappelle is concerned, he says some stuff people don't like, mm-hmm. and supposedly he hurt people. You know, I didn't listen to all of Cat. You know how I felt about that. Mm-hmm. You know, but he did say, Dave Chappelle went on to say about, I didn't put it in there, but you know, even whether Cat's right or wrong. Mm-hmm. That he didn't do everything right himself, and he didn't mention his shortcomings, mm-hmm. you know, so he said that. So, mm-hmm. yeah, mm-hmm. but it was a good story.
I mean, here's the funny thing about it, because I'm like, because I'm, you know, I follow all of these guys, and Dave, you got amnesia, because you were the first person I heard go off on Tyler Perry, Eddie Murphy, and Martin Lawrence for wearing a dress, and that you refused to. So when his whole world went awry when he decided, because it was a decision, nobody kicked him out, but he decided to leave the scene for many years and he bought a farm somewhere, I can't remember what state, he bought a farm somewhere and moved his family away and stayed out of the limelight for a long time, but he did interviews about his aggravation with Hollywood. But he spoke down about those comedians, and I have heard him down other comedians. So he has done it. But at the end of the day, what Kat was sharing was his truth. It was the truth, and it was the truth because it's proven. And it may not have been. And for you to say, "Oh, it's not good for the comedy scene," well, maybe it'll stop them from doing it. Number one, number two. We spend so much time sweeping stuff under the rug. That's what's wrong in our family situations a lot. We've swept incest under the rug. We've spent so much time sweeping stuff under the rug. Now, not to say that somebody ought to be the one that just comes out and blast everybody, but John McCat, you know, he was a little loose at the tongue and he told a whole lot of the business. But I guess
John McCat.
Huh?
John McCat.
Cat.
Williams. Oh, I thought you said John. I said,
but Cat, you know, he was a little inebriated, and he's told all the business. And you know, I probably in my personal, you know, I wouldn't have done it that way, but he chose to do it that way. And all of them have done something of the sort. They just didn't go down to the nitty gritty that Cat Williams did. And plus, he kept drinking out that cup. And the more he drank, the more he talked. So that was one of the other things too, where somebody's inebriated, just tell all. But yeah, so I just think that, you know, at the end of the day, I understand what Dave is saying. I do say a drunk mind tells no lies. I understand what Dave is saying, but also Dave, you're on the pot calling the kettle black because you have done it, sir. You've done it.
Yeah. The only thing that bugged me is, I know you're wonderful, Kat, but in them 50 years, you done some stuff too. You just probably ain't going to talk about it. Because ain't nobody, you can't be in the game and not do something wrong. You can't.
Of course. I'm sure he has. I mean, Cat Williams has been arrested like a gazillion times. His business is out there. But what?
I ain't know nothing about him.
I did. He's brilliant. He's a brilliant person. He reads a lot. He's brilliant beyond measure. However, all of us, the Bible says, for all the sin to come short.
Yeah. Course,
I'm sure he has done some stuff wrong. But from what he said, he ain't still nobody jokes. And that's what his frustration was with that, yeah, and with them lying, because he said they lie so much that, he's like, he was just fed up. I guess he was just fed up.
But it's just like Trump. You lie so much until people start believing it.
Yeah, that's true.
But you keep saying the same thing over and over and over, and watch people like what they said. Girl, that's a lie.
But it'll come up. It'll come up. Everything that's done in the dark will come to light. His stuff will come. If it's out there, trust me, it'll come. It will come.
If I had been one of the comedians, I just wouldn't comment it one way or the other.
Yeah, I just wouldn't have time to just shut up, because especially I know I stole it. Like Cedric, I would have shut up.
Yeah, I would have just moved on, because whatever happened, they ain't gonna change where they are now.
It's not.
If I stole your joke, okay, I'm sorry, but that wasn't the only joke he probably stole. You know what I'm saying?
See, even with from Cat's perspective, I probably would have just shut up, because I'd be looking bad in my little situation, like, well, I hope they don't know about such and such and such, and I hope nobody will come out and say this and this and this. And I hope nobody, you'd be like wondering, because people might know you from way back when.
All right.
Stuff, so you have to be careful what comes
out. I've seen plenty of times people go dig something you ain't never.
You thought was dead hearing. Man.
But I think they should move on. It's been said. Okay, all the people, their careers ain't changed. They still got making movies. I wouldn't care.
Yeah, they are all making it to some degree, but at the end of the day, he's a rich man, but as is Steve Harvey, as is Eddie Murphy, as is Martin Lawrence, they're all like doing well. And for the most part, most of the ones, some of them may not be,
Kevin Hart. I mean,
Kevin Hart, yeah, you're making movies and doing this thing, and Cat Williams still working. He's still working, still making videos, still getting casting, still getting calls. It happens, but
the amount of people stepped on people to get ahead.
In that industry, ridiculous. You what, girl? I got some stories for you. I can tell you some stories. All right, fellas, come on.
Moving, moving, moving. We keep it moving.
Okay. All right. Tyler Perry shared with his 7.6 million Instagram followers that South Carolina 94-year-old woman who captured the hearts of many as she stood up to a housing developer in a legal battle against the land has passed away. Yeah, we covered her. Mm-hmm. When developers attempted to induce her to sell the Hilton Head land she had been living on for decades, and then took her to court for her land. Yeah. That part really bugged me, in a dispute about property boundaries. The filmmaker stepped in, promising to support her fight. Josephine Wright, a woman of Gulen ancestries, gained national attention in a David and Goliath fight against Bailey Point Investment LLC. They thought, they picked the wrong fight. In February 2023, Bailey Point initiated a lawsuit alleging that sections of her 1.8 acre parcel resident encroached upon their property. Really? Wright's home sits on the land and has been in her family since the 19th century. However, situated behind a resident on Jonesville Road on Hilton Head, Bailey Point is in the process of constructing a 147-unit development. In July 2023, in the thick of a fight, she said, I just want to keep this as a sanctuary, according to WSAV. Another uptick in her profile came after her granddaughter launched a GoFundMe last summer to bring awareness to her fight with the developers. The goal was $350,000. Was exceeded by almost 17,000. Her children and grandchildren assured those supporting the campaign that the family is setting up the Josephine Wright Foundation to keep her spirit and dream alive. The billionaire filmmaker wrote this week about being thwarted in his desire that he was going to do it, and his desire to present Wright with her new house. I am so heartbroken to hear about her passing, about the passing of this warrior. Miss Josephine Wright, even though we spoke by phone, I was looking forward I'm looking forward to meeting you in person next month to hand you the keys to your new house. But God had other plans. Perry wrote on
Instagram. I gave her a mansion instead.
Wow. Yeah. My prayer is that you rest in peace, knowing I will honor the commitment that I made to you. He added, I know you will be watching over us as I hand those keys to your family. Perry continued, so your four children, 40 grandchildren, 50 great-grandchildren, and four great-great-grandkids children will be able to be able to gather at your home, at your house, on your land, and tell the world what kind of fighter that you were. I love it.
I do too.
I love it. Story. You know, and this is what I was saying earlier. We say what people not doing, people that money, but that's because we don't read. Mm-hmm. Oh, well, they got all that money. No, this man that promised her a house.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so.
And he's going to make good on it.
He's making good on his promise.
We could always see in Tyler Perry's history, regardless of what people think about him and say about him and all this stuff, you always have seen that he is an extreme giver. And
he surely is.
I have seen him there was one pastor that was sitting on a roof. He was on the Tom Jones Morning Show saying that he was going to stay on this roof until, you know, they raised enough money to build the outreach center. It was in a very bad part of Chicago. And the Saints and everybody were concerned about him because there's shootings all the time. And when bullets go up, they come down. And he was sleeping on the roof. It's like, you got bullets casings falling all around you because, you know, there's shootings going on all the time. And you could get hit by a bullet, the stray bullet coming down, because what goes up must come down. And so... Yeah. I heard Tyler say, Pastor, how much you short? And he's like, oh, we're about $100,000 short. We're trying to get raised $100,000. He said, get up, come off the roof, Pastor. I got you $100,000. Just come down off the roof. and I've witnessed that a few times. So, my heart is sad that she didn't get to live to see it.
But I know what.
Plans. God had other plans. He decided to give her a mansion. And, you know, take her out of this world of sickness and sadness and all that stuff, and to take her to a place where she won't have to cry and won't have to be trying to beckon for property and anything anymore, because she's with the father who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. So we applaud her story and we applaud her for what he's doing. That's a great story.
Yeah, it really is.
All right, fellas, come on, take us to our last one.
Moving, moving, moving. We keep it moving.
Y'all know we like to end it with a little history, so we're going to go to the history conversation now of our show. Laura A. Moore, was born to enslaved parents Amelia and Richard Moore in Tipton County, Tennessee, and likely spent the first several years of her life as an enslaved person. After 5 years of tutoring from Rachel Alexander, a scholar from Oberlin College, Moore began tutoring other Black girls in her community at only 11 years old. She enrolled at Central Tennessee College in 1872, completing the normal course in 1876, and then, at the urging of her teachers, going on to pursue the school's classical course. She graduated in 1880, the only woman in her class, and later received an AM from the same school in 1885. On July 4th, 1880, Moore married the Reverend Charles P. Westbrook, one of her classmates at Central Tennessee College. The couple had a daughter named Bertie Lee Westbrook, who was born in 1883. In December 1880, the Westbrooks moved to Victoria, Texas, where Laura became principal of the Victoria City School, and Charles became principal of the Jones Male and Female Institute. Westbrook later joined her husband at the Jones Institute, teaching there for 4 years. Sometime in the mid-1880s, the couple moved to Waco, Texas, where Laura taught at the W.H. Mission School and served as the second vice president of the Colored Teachers Institute in McLellan County, Texas. Around 1889, she began teaching in the Waco Public School District. During her career as a teacher, Westbrook worked with the advisory board of Texas 22nd Senatorial District to help secure scholarships and financial aid for Black applicants to Prairie View A&M University, then called Prairie View State Normal Institute, the first state-supported college for African Americans in the United States. In addition to her work in education, Westbrook also a social and religious activist. During her time at W.H. Mission School, she also served as the corresponding secretary for the white House Mission Society of West Texas conference in a position held until at least 1893. She traveled throughout Texas for her mission work, lecturing at Methodist Episcopal churches, and in 1888 attended the WH Mission Convention Boston as a delegate. Westbrook was also a member of the Texas State Chapter of the Women's Christian Temperance Union, which became the first WCTU branch of the South to endorse women's suffrage in 1888. Westbrook drew upon her teaching skills in her work with the WCTU, traveling through the South to speak in support of the temperance cause. Her contemporaries described her lectures as electrifying and inspiring. Westbrook died in 1894 at the age of 35. Her cause of death is unknown. Wow, she died young. I was wondering why everything was like within the same time frame, because everything she did was right there. She fulfilled her purpose.
Yeah. She did. She did a lot in a short time.
Amen. She did. 35.
I said 35.
Oh, yeah,
you did all that. So I think she was brilliant.
Yeah, brilliant. Based if you on, did yeah, all yeah. of that in 35 years,
35 that's years?
That's a lot. God is good. So we do applaud her life and her legacy for the 35 years that she was here on earth. Did more than something. We do applaud her. All right, good people. Well, we've come to the end of our broadcast. We thank you all so much for tuning in, but we've come to the end. And we have a few things that we want you to do before you leave. Please, ma'am, please share the video that you're watching is on Facebook, YouTube, or X, formerly known as Twitter. Please subscribe, like, and share. You can also sow a seed. You can sow via Cash App, which is $Movement Worldwide, Zelle, info@movementworldwide.org, or become a monthly covenant partner giver by becoming a patron. You can go to our website, movementworldwide.org, click the red button. It will take you to patreon.com, where you can set up your account and set your amount. We ask for $12 a month, which is 40 cents a day, $2.80 a week. But no matter what size the gift is, it's all greatly appreciated. And we thank you so much for being a giver, not only in your ENTS, your gifts, your seed, but also your ENCE, your presence here with us. So thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir, so much. Also, everywhere that you see that global above the net's head with that acronym, that is us. Join us on all platforms and follow us. Yes. And then you can email us your thoughts, views, comments, praise reports, prayer requests, topic ideas to info@movementworldwide.org. Now for just a rundown of what we have going on all week. On Tuesdays, Annette L. Anderson, actually go to her website, AnnetteLAnderson.com. Don't leave the L out, AnnetteLAnderson.com. Go to her website. You can see all of the many things that she offers. But on Tuesday night, she's booed up with her husband, Leonard, the pastor. So she's booed up on Tuesday nights to grace us with her presence with TNT with the Andersons. What's TNT? I'm glad you asked. It's TNT. That's Tuesday Night Talk, where we take flight and soar. That speak, orate, articulate, reverberate. That speak, orate, articulate, and reverberate live every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. on this platform, Facebook, YouTube, and X, formerly known as Twitter. And then on Wednesday nights, join us right back here again to let your hair down, have a very practical conversation with us, our threefold conversation on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. live called Can We Talk? Absolutely. Yes, we can. We can start with those idioms, those phrases, those comments, those quotes, those things that make you go, And that's our transformational topic. And then we go to the heart to have conversation. And it rips off that Band-Aid. Y'all like my sound effect?
With the tool.
And then we have some fun where we go from the good, the bad, and the ugly. We keep it light, but keep it real. And we give a little history with our tea time topics. So that's Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. live on Facebook, YouTube, and X, formerly known as Twitter. And then on Fridays, if you are not there on Friday nights, you are missing. God is doing some good things on Clubhouse, y'all. Download that app. I was like, acronym. Download that app. Look for me. Look for Annette. Look for the globe and the acronym. Look for us on Clubhouse, and we'll get you to the right place. But if you are still technologically challenged, please, and if you're not still, Text the word movers. We want you to text the word movers. We want you to text the word, text the word, text the word, text the word movers. I'll give y'all a little remix. Two. 954 8 20 50 50 We want you to text the word movers to 954 8 20 5 0 5 0. You'll get a link into the building with the into the room already in progress, and you'll also get notifications when we're live and we have other things going on. And then, we want you, ma'am and sir, to join us right back here on this platform on Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. for Power Walk Sunday, where we inspire and motivate you to walk into your God-given destiny with power and conviction, where there is always, say always, Annette.
Ways.
Where there is always a word for you. Your last thoughts.
All righty. Well, I want my last thought to be, time is on my side. Mm-hmm. Time is on your side. Mm-hmm. So just know, need it so eloquently, broke it down. Man, that's good.
Yes. Well, time is on your side and God's going to restore. So don't think that you've missed out or lost anything. Yes. And as we get older, God will change the roles in our life. But don't resist it. Just go with the flow and let him transition you. Because still, even in that, time is on your side. All right, good people, we love you. We thank you all for tuning in, but we got to go. So we're going to leave y'all with some love and some kisses. And we'll see y'all the next time. Bye-bye, everybody.
Walk into your God-given destiny with power and conviction with Power Walk Sunday. Each and every Sunday at 10 a.m. live on multiple platforms. When we eat well, we live well, and all will be well. Go to elbwell.com, join the journey, and take your life back. TNT, that's Tuesday Night Talk with the Andersons, each and every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. live on multiple platforms. For more information and other services, visit AnnetteLAnderson.com. Your faithful co-hosts, Annette and Anita, along with the best mods this side of heaven, are live on Clubhouse in the Movers and Shakers house with Operation Manifestation every Friday night at 8 p.m. You don't want to miss this fiery conversation. If you don't have your copy yet, get yours today at Amazon.com. That's Living Life One Quote at a Time by Annette L. Anderson. Another milestone reached. Get your copy of The Wow Effect by Anita Faye Wilson, available on all platforms, or you can visit AnitaFayeWilson.com. And you can always catch us live on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for Can We Talk? Join us with your Can We Talk coffee mug. Get yours today. They're $15 and that includes shipping. So good seed into good soil. You can sow a seed into Movement Worldwide via Cash App at $Movement Worldwide, Zelle at info@movementworldwide.org, or by becoming a patron. You can visit our website at movementworldwide.org, click the red button, go to patreon.com, and set up your account today. And remember to follow us on all platforms, like, subscribe, click that notification button, and don't forget to share.